And welcome to Playing Away, the show where we meet representatives, players, managers, staff and volunteers from our upcoming opponents, and we discuss everything about the matchday experience, non-league and their clubs. This week's guest is Steve Palfrey from Pilkington, current secretary, former manager, former player. I think he's done just about everything you can do at the club. But before we get him on, a couple of bits to go through. What a run we're on. Since Christmas, we've played 5, won 5, scored 23 goals and only conceded once. The momentum that the lads have got is amazing. The players that we've brought in are only strengthening the squad. I mean, hat-trick hero, Jacob Holland Wilkinson. We're going to show you some of his first interview with the club in a minute. But wow, what a run we're on. 10-1 in the last game. I don't think I've ever seen anything quite like it in my life. And long may it continue. Now, let's have a look at that interview.
A debut hat-trick for yourself for Bury this afternoon. Just give us your overall thoughts.
I think it was a great team performance, obviously. Scoring 10 goals is something special. And to do it at home in front of the crowd was great. But on a personal note, it's good for me as well. Bit of confidence as well, so yeah.
And obviously, you came on, you started on the bench, and obviously you came on sort of inside 20 minutes with that injury to Charlie Doyle. I guess it's one of those when you're sort of on the bench, you're always ready to come on. I guess it's one of those you never really expect to come on so early in the game.
Yeah, when you're on the bench, you know, you always got to be ready to come on and make an impact, and I feel like we did that today, and yeah, it was good.
And obviously, 10 goals, 10 very different goals. I guess that it is good to sort of have that in the team, and obviously an array of different scorers, not just yourself, but the likes of Deck and Briggsy as well. I guess the gaffer must be pleased.
Yeah, he's over the moon. Look, it probably weren't one of our better performances, I think, but it's 10 goals is something special and it doesn't happen often. So to do it, like I said, at home in front of the crowd is something really special.
And obviously, as we said at the top, your debut for the club this afternoon. What can you tell the fans about yourself and why did you decide to join Bury?
I think it's a massive club, as everyone knows. The support's something that drew me to it as well. The gaffer told me his insight on what he wants to do here, and I think it really interested me. And I think it's a great opportunity for me to come play, like score goals and push on and get as high as possible.
And obviously, that first goal in front of a giggling crowd must be special. Just give us sort of your sort of thoughts and what that feeling was like when that goal went in.
I was over the moon. I think you realise there's a lot of people there, but when you score a goal, I think it's a lot different. But yeah, it was great feeling, and hope for many more.
And obviously, over the last couple of weeks, we've seen a lot of postponements, frustrations, and obviously amongst the fans, players and the management. With that, I guess all you can do is now prepare for next Saturday's game against Pilkington and sort of hope to carry on from where you've left off this afternoon.
Yeah, obviously when I signed, we've had 3 games now postponed, which has obviously been frustrating, because when you sign you want to play as many games as possible, but them games will be rescheduled and we'll take what we did today hopefully into next Saturday and hopefully kick on.
Other bits to touch on: club shop restock for the 10th of February game at home. Bucket hats will be on sale, limited supply, so if you want one of them, get down to the ground early, go in the club shop and get your Bury FC bucket hat. Plenty of other bits on sale as well. Pop in, support your club. Now, talking about support your club, one more thing, just a little bit serious, we need to talk about, and that is all of this online abuse that's going on between the fans at the moment. Regardless of ethnicity, age or gender, whether you've supported this club for 80 years or 80 minutes, whether you watched us under the AFC banner, whether you didn't, this is your club. We're in this together and we need to stop all the backbiting, personal attacks and petty name calling, and put all that energy into pushing Dave and the lads towards the promotion that this club needs and deserves. So please pack it in. We're all Bury fans. Let's just get on with it. Now, that's enough of that. Let's get Steve on. Steve, welcome to Playing Away. How are you doing?
I'm great, thanks, yeah. Yeah, busy, but great.
Brilliant. I really appreciate you taking the time to come on and speak to us. So I'll crack straight in. If you could introduce yourself and tell us about your role and how you became involved at Pilkington.
Okay. I'm now currently the secretary and treasurer as official roles. But I joined the club when I was around about 17 as a player, played in the first team, and then went on to manage both the reserves and the first team for quite a while. I mean, the period of the first team was around about 16 years that I managed the club. So, been heavily involved and heavily invested in the club, yes.
So if there's anyone that knows anything about Pilkington, it's going to be you.
Certainly, yeah.
I think last time I did this with Pilkington, I had Mark on.
Oh, Mark H, yeah.
When he was with you guys.
Yes,
moved on now, hasn't he?
Yes, he has, yeah.
Back in the Division 1 days.
Yes, that's correct, yeah.
So, we'll just get straight into it. Tell us about the history of Pilkington. I mean, I know bits. A lot of our fans won't, but I read the club was formed in 1938, but there's a bit more history than that before that as well, I read.
Yeah, it was originally formed as a works team. I think it's around about the 1920s is the earliest records that we have of the club. And it used to just play in the works leagues, and that was intercompany works leagues, because at the time, obviously, Pilkington Glass was very, very big within St. Helens, so there would have been numerous teams just within that league alone, numerous different departments within Pilkington who'd have their own teams. So that's where it started life out, and then I think it was 1938 that it formed as a team that then went into the into competition. So it would have been Liverpool County Com, I would imagine, at the time. They went into that first. And then they finally settled around about the 80s in the Cheshire League. Like I say, traditionally, it was workers for the club. But obviously that opened up as it's moved on in its history. And spent most of its time in the Cheshire League until it got promoted. We got promoted in 2018, I think it was. 18, or I forget now. 18 or 19 into the Northwest Counties.
Fantastic. I do remember when Bury AFC were coming into the league 2019-20, that time. Pilkington was still a fairly new counties side. They'd been in the feeder leagues, but you'd only been in the counties for a little while.
I think that was our first season, actually. Our first season in the league, in the counties, yeah.
Yeah. Excellent. So, you know, the club's been around for a bit. You're right, is it right behind or right next to the factory as well, isn't it, Ruskin? Is that correct?
Yes, it's just one of the factories. There's a couple of factories within the town still working, but one of the factories is a stone's throw away, yeah, and you can see the chimneys when you arrive at Ruskin, and you can also see the old Pilkington Glass headquarters as well.
Right, cool. So in that history, have there been any particular players of note that have gone on, moved on and played elsewhere, higher up in the echelons of football?
I think everybody always talks about Phil Marsh. I think he was a young lad who was at Manchester United. He only got one appearance there, but he was under the guidance of Fergie. Any others? We have a board in there, and you've put me on the spot there. Brian Griffiths in Wigan Athletic. So we've had a couple of players, but they. I can't think of them at this moment in time.
I think Phil was still playing when Bury AFC came.
Yes, he would have been. Yeah, he was in our team at that time. Yeah,
Stalwart was he? Was he there for a while?
Well, he was here for three or four seasons. I think he came down through the non-league when he left Manchester United, and then played a couple of games. He had another broken leg playing football. He suffered a broken leg playing football and then played local leagues and then came into Pilkington when we went into the North West Counties, actually. Spent a couple of seasons here then.
Excellent. Now, move on. This season, how's it been?
I think it's been an okay season. We set our target really to be competitive and to certainly stay in the league. But we would have liked to have been higher than where we are now at this current time. We've had a bit of a reality check in terms of there are some big clubs in this league with big resources and trying to compete with them. I think we've had to kind of readjust where we are. So it's been a bit of a difficult ride, an up and down ride. We've had some great results and we've had some very poor results as well.
Really. You've had a very, I was on your Northwest Counties page earlier and your players list is probably nearly as long as ours. Because am I right, have you had a change of management mid-season?
Yes. Well, I started the season as manager. And then I relinquished it in just after the Bury game, actually, straight after the Bury game, the last Bury game. I felt that was the right time for me to leave. I felt it was a great occasion for us playing at Bury in front of 2,500, fans was superb for us as a club, considering we're a Works League club. You know, we're not a town club like others. We're a Works League, so we've gone on a big journey. I mean, if you consider in 2016, we were one team. I mean, I remember playing at Main Road Reserves in the Cheshire League and not being able to get 11 players out and having to play myself. You know, and the growth from that to where we are now has been very, very rapid. We're now 42 teams, I think, within the club. Wow. When we talk about all the right the way from the reception up to adult football in both boys and girls football.
That's
so
phenomenal.
You know, three women's teams, obviously a first team and a very good under 23s team as well, which is good backup for the future, really. So it's gone on a big journey, and a very rapid journey, and I think it's kind of got to the stage it's at now in the County's Prem in what is a very tough season when you look at some of the clubs that are in it this year. And I think certainly we're battling against resources that are bigger than us at moments in time. And I think for the club, it needs to kind of assess where it's at and build a bit of foundation, really. So, you know, we're happy. We're happy that we're in, and we're being competitive. And I think as long as we stay in the league this year, which is the important milestone, we can build from there then.
Definitely. And is a lot of the infrastructure with the juniors and the women's team, is that down to the artificial surface and you can have teams training on it, playing on it? Does that help with that as well?
Definitely, without doubt. I mean, the catalyst for the change of this club was the installation of the 3G in 2017. Made a massive difference to us, really. You can put two or three games on a Saturday and a Sunday. If any of the Bury fans come down at 9 o'clock on Saturday morning, they'll see hundreds of kids on the pitches playing. And when you get down here, you'll realise we've also got a 3G rugby pitch at the side. So we're doubling up on a Saturday morning in terms of the teams that we've got. So, massively important, really.
I remember last time when we came down and the media team arrived, because we always get there early-ish, and the kids were still playing as we arrived. And it's brilliant to see, and it's definitely something I think that our club are looking at as well, is getting hopefully an artificial surface in at some point, which will help us kick on massively, I think.
People who don't like him, and you know, I get that, really. I mean, I'm old school, so you're playing a piece of grass, you think it's so much better, but you know, the practicalities of it for clubs these days, it just seems to be a no-brainer for most clubs, and I think everyone's got to accept that we've got to move forwards a little bit, really, in that sense.
Definitely. Well, this show is called Playing Away, so I better get on to the match day and us playing away. Tell us about your ground, what it's called, where it's located.
Well, it's called the Arca Frame Stadium. We're located on Ruskin Sports Village, which has got a multitude of rugby 3G pitch, a rugby union pitch, a couple of more football pitches, and a cricket ground as well in front of the wicket. Okay, the wicket is the bar. We're pre-match. There'll be hopefully plenty of drinks.
I've been in the wicket. It's lovely. It's very, very nice. And there is a pie hut slash bar in the ground, isn't there, as well?
Yes, there's a small kiosk in the ground as you enter the ground. There's two turnstiles at the front. There'll be two turnstiles on Saturday operating. We've made the game. We give pre-sales on tickets so that people can get in easier. So I think that's going to be through one of the turnstiles. If you've got a ticket, you would go through that one. If you're paying card or cash, you go through the other one. So hopefully we can get the queues through quickly. So, yeah, there is a little kiosk in there. That'll be serving pies. It'll probably have, I think they're going to do salt and pepper chicken as well on there as well. And you can get cans there and hot drinks as well. In the bar itself, in the wicket, we've got an outdoor space now. There's an outdoor bar as well under cover. So that'll be open as well on Saturday for anybody who's attending.
Excellent. Now, there's a fair bit of parking available. Is there something like 400 spaces?
Yeah, we have 400 spaces in total. There are two, as you come onto the site, there's two immediate car parks. And then if you go right, you end up on a car park that's nearer to the ground. If you go left, there's an overflow car park as well. So there's going to be plenty of parking spaces for everyone.
I remember, I think it was your place where we had to walk over a little bridge.
Yes, we have a little bridge that you walk over. Yeah. You have to come over the brook to get onto the village, really.
Yeah. It's a really nice facility down there. It's lovely. Having the bar and all the green space around us. It's quite a nice place to be when you're at the wicket, especially. For fans, once they're in the stadium, there are, if I remember rightly, there's one seated stand. Is that right?
Yes. I think it holds 250.
That's behind the goal, isn't it?
No, it's to the side.
Is it the side?
To the side, yes. Yeah.
And then either end, are you one of the grounds where you can't go around all four sides, aren't you?
Yeah, so we're only three-sided. We're only three-sided. You can't go down the left-hand side where the dugouts are.
Yeah, perfect. For those that travel up earlier in the day, perhaps want to indulge in a bit of a local fare, local cuisine, is there anywhere prior to getting down to Ruskin that you would recommend them going to in the local area?
No, just the wicket.
Get in the wicket. That's
what. Get in the wicket. There's food there. There's beer. That's all you need. There's eight screens for TVs. We're opening the back as well, the studio, which can host 80 people with a big screen, 3 meter screen. So if you want to watch any of the games, or if you want to stay afterwards, by all means, if there's any particular games on that they wanted to watch, then we have it all there.
Fantastic. I remember coming down there last time and they had the football on, and there was a few people in very early doors as well at the wicket, so it'd be a good atmosphere in there.
Well, it opens from 9, and if anybody, there's also an on-site spa and fitness club, so if they want to go in there beforehand,
hey, there we go. If you want to go and earn your pints,
exactly. Yeah,
get down there, get in the gym.
Yeah, I think they do day memberships. They do day memberships for that, and I know there's a 5-star luxury spa here now as well, so you can have a nice treatment as well if they want.
Fantastic. Now on to Saturday, onto the game, onto more on-field affairs. Last time we met at Gig Lane back in November. Ended 3-1, two very late goals for Bury. How much has the squad changed between then and now?
It's changed quite a lot, to be fair. We've lost a few players, with the movement of management since then. A few players have decided to leave. A few have been, as happens, they've been picked off by other clubs. So there has been a lot of changes to the squad. So it's a lot younger, maybe a little bit more inexperienced. So it's going to be a tough game. I think there's no doubt that it will be a tough game. But Matty Potter and Kev Langley, who've come in, I've only had a week or so to work with them. But we could see a lot of improvements on Saturday in the Chatterton game in the way that they were organised. So I certainly feel as though we'll be very, very organised and hard to break down, I think.
Fantastic. Chatterton aren't an easy team to play either. No. I think they've taken 6 points off us this season, I think.
Good side, yeah.
Because we've played each other earlier in the season. If there was a Bury player that you wish could have the day off, who would it be?
Skaz. Yeah. Any chance?
Yeah. He's very good.
Okay, come on.
I mean, ones to watch from this new crop of players from your lot. Who could excite the Bury fans? Who's got that turn of pace or that little bit of magic in them?
Obviously we've got Taylor Prescott, who hopefully will be fit, and I would guess would start somewhere up the front. He's got plenty of pace, so I'd hope that he would test your defence. Certainly one to watch. And a young guy, Adam Bott as well. I like the look of him. He's only been with us a couple of weeks, and I think he's at Chester under 18. So, you know, he's very, very lively and very tidy on the ball. So, certainly watch out for those two.
Excellent. And I'm really looking forward to the game. And the 3G at the moment for us always seems to be the great leveller. So
definitely, yeah. We've looked at your results on those, and I think we do feel, and it was a close game when you came down here in 2019. I think it was our goalkeeper passed the ball into the back of one of the players.
Greavesy hid behind him.
Yeah.
bit of a lapse in concentration, but you know, yeah. It's going to be a good game. I'm going to do it. What's your score prediction?
Oof. I'd like to see a 2-2 draw. In reality, I think there will be a win there for Bury, if I'm honest. But you know, you might just be too strong for us.
I'm going to say, coming off the back of Saturday, I don't know what he fed him before the game on Saturday, but if he's got any of it left, I'm going to say, you know, with the momentum from that, I'm going to say 4-2.
Yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
And that's, I think, purely just because of the momentum. They're just on some run at the minute.
Well, they've got some great quality in there, and I think if you've got to be on your ball from the first minute, and any small mistakes, which seems to be the thing that is our theme at the moment, it's going to get punished, and you know, it's understandable when you're playing against players of that quality, really, that's going to happen.
I mean, the good thing about having a young squad, though, is that you can mould them this season, try and retain your position in the league, and then next season they'll have that just a little bit more experience, so it's a great position to be in, really, with a lot of youngsters.
Yeah, I mean, it's very much the change of focus within the club. I think we understand that, you know, we have our ceilings, really, of what we can do. And I think, you know, we're the last couple of seasons, we've tended to go and try and be able to get players within the league, the top players within the league of the level we was playing at, and be able to bring them into the squad and move forward that way. I think we've got to completely refocus now and look at what talent we've got internally in the under 20. We've got a very, very strong under 23s, and I think it's time to give them the chances, really, to blood them ready for maybe a more, you know, top eight, top five finish next year and move on that way. The club has to just reassess and re-level itself, I think, really, at this moment in time.
We're really, really looking forward to our visit on Saturday. It's always a nice place to come. It's a friendly place to come as well. But I've got one final question for you. And that is, if you could say one thing to anyone that hasn't been to the local non-league side that convinced them to come down, give it a go, not watch Sky Sports for the day and see if they were interested, what would it be?
Well, I think it's authentic, isn't it? You don't get players diving. You don't get referees who want to be the... Well, mind you, sometimes you do get referees who want to be the star of the show, but certainly I think with the VAR situation at the moment, you come into non-league, you're seeing authentic football and exciting football, and it's, that's the most important thing, is it's genuine. And I think if anybody comes down, they'll have a really good day out. Not a relatively expensive day out as well. and enjoy a good game of football, I think.
You could probably bring your entire family, your auntie, your uncle and all your cousins for the price of what it costs to go and watch City or United for one ticket to a non-league game. And that's what I love about it.
Yeah.
A pie, a pint, a programme and a match ticket for 20 quid is...
Superb value for money, and you get the excitement as well.
Oh, that is one last question. Sorry, I did forget to ask you. Do you do a programme? Because I know there will be people wanting to know.
Yes, we do a programme. Yes, there will be one there on the day, yeah.
There we go. I'm going to try and edit that back into earlier.
At the beginning.
No, Steve, I really appreciate you coming on, and thank you for giving us an insight into Pilkington, and look forward to seeing you on Saturday. Thanks for coming on, Steve. What a guy. I look forward to meeting you on Saturday as our clubs meet in the North West Counties Premier. Just a couple of reminders, obviously, Club Shop restock 10th of February for that home game. There'll be plenty of stuff in. Get over there, see the guys, support the club, get some of the white and blue army merch, help support their future flag displays. And once again, please just stop fighting with each other online. We need to stick together, get behind this club and get us the promotion that we deserve. I'll be back in the next episode with quite an exciting one. Before we travel to the Isle of Man, got a couple of great guests on. Drop a like on the video if you're off to the Isle of Man. What a weekend it's going to be. And I'll see you then.